Well, good morning, friends. Grace and peace to you in the name of the risen Christ. It is a blessing to see everyone here. My name is Reverend Jeff Prothrow, and I want to make a special welcome to any visiting guests who are joining us this morning, and welcome everyone who is joining us online for this time of worship. I hope it is a time of blessing and grace for all of you. But before we begin worship, we do need to offer a quick prayer for Reverend Kim, who was, it's a bit of a mystery, but he has a broken toe. And so we just want to be in prayer for the healing of his sacred toe. So we will be in prayer. He assures me it had nothing to do with anything that happened during the Super Bowl. It was just a simple accident. And so for that, we are grateful. Blessings on your healing and all of that. Well, friends, this morning we celebrate Transfiguration. It is a fantastical event, one that is mysterious, strange. It's okay to admit that we probably still really don't know what went on that mountaintop. But it will help us prepare our hearts, I believe, for the Lenten season. Ash Wednesday is this coming Wednesday, and we will have two services at first at noon in our chapel, down clear at our east end, and then the 7 o'clock in the evening for our Ash Wednesday service in the sanctuary. But I think Transfiguration Sunday really helps us prepare for what is to come with Lent. And so I'm very excited to celebrate Transfiguration with all of you, to offer some words, and for us to worship together on this special Sunday in the life of faith. Well, friends, take a few moments. We've got announcements on the back of our bulletin for those who are wanting our ongoing prayer concern list. Out in our welcome area, you are welcome to take those lists home with you and pray those names in your own prayer life, as we, again, are a community that is ready to share in one another's joys and concerns together. This is a place of blessing. May this be a time of grace as we continue our time of worship together. You're invited to stand as you are able as Reverend Kim leads us in the call to worship.
The light of God is shining around and within. The voice of God is calling not just from ancient texts, but from here and now. And the love of God is with us, flowing around and within us. And let us join each other in our opening song, the verse 1 of Word of God, Speak and Open the Eyes of My Heart.
Thing I
Friends, let's take a few moments to welcome one another this morning.
Well, as Pastor Jeff mentioned, today is Transfiguration Sunday, and it is a threshold day. This week, we step from the season after Epiphany into Lent. It also provides a chance to mark a step from one reality into another. The colors will be different, the sounds will be different, the feel will be different. And my broken toe, well, it's a kind of perfect beginning for Lent. And it will be different. I mean, it will be healed. So we will be transformed into God's image. And looking around, we may think to ourselves, Toto, I have a feeling we aren't in Kansas anymore. So friends, let us center upon God's transforming love as we now pray the centering prayer with one voice. Holy light of God, shine upon us in this moment. We come to you as we are, in our strength and in our weakness. Bless our world in all its beauty and its pain. With your Spirit's redeeming power, as you transfigured Jesus on a mountaintop, transform us as we worship you this today. Touch us with the presence of your Spirit, that we may shine Christ's light into a world longing for peace. Amen. Let us continue to pray in silence. Lord of mystery and marvels, as we are about to enter our season of Lent again, be with us now, reminding us that the journey to the cross does not end in death, but becomes a road of joy. Lift our hearts and our spirits to sing your praises in gratitude for all that you have done for us. Let the light of Jesus Christ shine on us, in us, and through us as we witness to your eternal presence and love for us. We offer this prayer in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I invite our children to come forward for our children's time. Guys, all right, couple questions. Anybody here know my favorite college sports team? What?
KU.
Okay. How about my favorite NFL team? Chiefs. All right. How do you guys know that? Yeah. All right. I'm always rooting for them, right? I've talked about them. Yeah, I live in the area. So this one's a little bit harder. No guessing. You have to know, okay? Do any of you know what my favorite food is? No guessing. You have to know for sure. How might you find out? Ask me, right?
What's your favorite food?
Tacos! Thanks for playing along. I appreciate it. Good job, Luke. All right. So, you know, that's how we get to know people, right? We ask questions and we listen to them and what they like, what they do, who is in their family. Asking and listening to other people can help us too. You know, my mom and dad could tell you things about me. So could my brother. So could my friends. But guys, how do we know about God?
He made us love him.
How do you know that?
Because everybody loves God.
Okay. You know, I think the Bible tells us things. We can learn things by coming to church, right? We sit here and we listen. So let's listen to our Bible story today. And let's see what we can hear about who God is, who Jesus is, and what people might be learning. All right? Can we listen? All right.
Yes, today's Bible story is from Matthew chapter 17, verses 1 to 9. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and his brother John and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became bright as light. Suddenly, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah, talking with him. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will set up 3 tents here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my son, the beloved. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Get up and do not be afraid." And when they raised their eyes, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them, "Tell no one about the vision until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God.
So first, we have this story because of someone else. Right? Somebody else wrote it down so that we would know. Right? And we would know something about God and something about Jesus. Do you know what it said? What happened to Jesus? Anybody remember? Jesus' appearance changed? Yeah. His clothes changed. Yeah, and God said, "This is my son. Listen to him." Right? And P- Peter and James and John, they wanted to stay up there. This is really cool. Let's just stay here. You ever been in that place? Yeah, where you're in someplace really cool and you don't want to leave? Maybe vacation, right? But you know what? They had to leave. And do you know why they had to leave?
No.
So that they could tell others and love others. Because they had this amazing experience to share. And that's how we have the story. If they would have stayed on the mountain, I don't know if we would have had the story, guys. Right? So, what does this teach us? What do you think? To be kind? Yeah. That we can't just stay here or enjoy the cool places. We have a story to tell and love to share. Okay. Can we pray together?
Yeah.
Will you guys repeat after me? God, we know you love us. And you know all about us. Thank you for revealing yourself to us. Help us to show others your love. Amen. Mr. Tate's in the back. Walk, and Mr. Tate will take you upstairs to Children's Church.
Thank you.
Amen. Every now and then you just experience total transcendence, and it's okay, and it's a good thing. Friends, will you pray with me and for me? Holy God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be a faithful response to the Spirit moving among us in this place, in this moment. Amen. Well, as all of you know, Kansas is not known for its mountains. But I guarantee we all can experience that mountaintop moment. I remember when I was a freshman in high school, this would have been 1989, and it was late fall. I was in my driveway with some friends, and we were playing basketball. It was in the evening. Now, we didn't have a goal, but that didn't stop us from throwing the ball against the side of the house and pretending we were scoring. But we were dribbling around. It was dark, and, you know, we were doing all those things that you do with a basketball. And one of them stopped and looked up and kind of had just that look on his face, like, oh my gosh, something is happening. And it took us a moment because this person, I think it was Brock, he was speechless. And so finally we all looked up. And what we saw was actually pretty indescribable, because moving across the night sky was this bright light full of different light. And it was swirly, and it was just something amazing that literally was just cutting across the sky. It looked like an animator, a painter, had just drawn something amazing and then just released it into the world. And here we were, these teenage boys in this driveway, just stopping and staring at this thing as it just cut itself across the sky. And what was interesting, after this happened, we didn't know what to say to one another, and we just kind of left at that point. And I went inside, and I told my dad, you will not believe what I just saw. And he kind of had a funny look on his face. You know, it's like, I don't know what you're talking about. And now, eventually it came out, there was a logical explanation for it. It was an old Russian satellite that had fallen and was re-entering the atmosphere that was causing this brilliant light show. At least that's what they told us. I think it was something much different. It was a vision that stirred something in me that has always struck. And I remember for the next couple of days, as I was talking to people in class about it, that there was just this sense of amazement. And I just couldn't quite put my finger on where have I seen that before, because I felt like, gosh, I had seen this somewhere before. I know what it is. It's stirring a memory or something inside of me. And then I was sitting in German class, Herr Butler's class, you know, and I can't speak German, so don't ask, but I was in the class. And one of the things that Herr Butler liked to do was show us photos of paintings and stuff and say, you know, to help stir our own imagination. And then it dawned on me, because this painting popped up that was just such a remarkable copy of what I had seen, that I started spewing stuff in German, like, oh my God, there it is! It was a picture of Van Gogh's The Starry Night. And it was like, wow, that is what I saw on that night. And it was just a wonderful moment, this moment of epiphany, that there it was, and I can finally grasp it a little bit, this moment. Because I really love the swirly stars of this night sky. The contrast between light and dark is exhilarating. It's like, wow, and there it was. That is what I experienced that night. And that is what I see in this painting. And now as I see this painting, I can't help but also notice something within there. Because in the midst of this grand canvas of these beautiful swirling stars, you see down at the lower center, this little church that's almost overtaken, by the stars. And so a question I have, does this church recognize the brilliant around it? Does it see the magnificence of the sky and creation itself as imagined by Van Gogh? Or is it content to not look up or to look more fully at what is unfolding, which is viewing the world through a new lens? I mean, it really is remarkable. And so now I think about that church that's nestled down in the valley. Now, several years later, I did have opportunity to actually see the painting. I was in New York City and stopped by the Museum of Modern Art, and you're walking around, and all of a sudden, there it is. And, you know, it is even more brilliant when you get to see it up close. But the thing that was interesting about my viewing was, you know, a big crowd was around it. And almost everybody, you know, hardly anybody was actually looking at it with their eyes, but rather everybody had either a camera or a cell phone up to take a picture. And so they were actually seeing it through the lens of something else rather than fully experience it. They were so engrossed in wanting to, you know, we've got to capture the moment, that they, I think, kind of lost the bigger picture. They weren't able to fully see what was in front of them, to fully comprehend, because they, all these folks, and I've done this myself, I've been to museums where I've probably taken more pictures than actually looking at the paintings, but they were content and not seeing it fully, but rather trying to capture something that perhaps couldn't be captured. Now, I say all of this, I give this introduction to demonstrate that this is how I feel about the Transfiguration. This is how I understand it. This remarkable story of Jesus, a moment that's beyond even what our own senses can fully comprehend. Now, there are two other major figures that appear. It's interesting. Here we have these three disciples with Jesus, and all of a sudden there's Elijah and Moses, you know, these major folks within their own historical consciousness, and they're demonstrating a through line from Israel's past to the world's present. And all these people, you know, Jesus is talking with them, and there's this promise. You know, we come to understand with both Elijah and Moses, who is at the forefront of the Exodus, and there's this promise of this return of an Exodus and this full communion with God, and it is awe-inspiring. But is it comprehensible? And so Peter, God bless Peter, God bless the Peters among us, feels like, you know, instead of just standing back and being like, oh my gosh, what am I experiencing? There's this compulsion to do something, to be busy rather than simply absorb what is happening. Again, his way of taking the picture, of trying to preserve this moment, is to try to build these little tents or booths for Jesus and Elijah and Moses. But how many of us, you know, during times where something we don't understand is happening, we try to look busy. We try to get busy. We try to fill in that space that we can't quite figure out with something that we can be in control of. Here, Jesus is having a mountaintop experience and is sharing it with these three disciples. Jesus is being prepared for a journey that will only lead to the cross. But again, our human capacity to not understand those things that are transcendent leads us to fall back on our old ways of thinking and doing. Peter's reaction, while it's easy to criticize, it certainly cuts close to the bone. We can recognize, because I think we're invited to see ourselves in Peter. We want to tell him to stop what he is doing and look at Jesus, to listen to Elijah and Moses and Jesus have this conversation, and to have himself prepared to come down from the mountain when the vision is over. But why wouldn't he, though, along with the other disciples, want to stay up on that mountain, to take that snapshot and look at the photo over and over again, rather than come down? I mean, this is something that just doesn't happen every single day. Why wouldn't he busy himself in the presence of Christ to seek and preserve the transcendence? It's a completely reasonable reaction when we think about it. But the transfiguration of Jesus offers a glimpse of what is possible, not only for Jesus, but for all humanity. And so for this reason, you know, this last verse in the narrative is, you know, just somewhat maybe confusing, maybe it's disappointing for some. We're trying to fully comprehend it ourselves. Jesus tells them not to tell anyone. Hey, you just witnessed this. You just saw this. But be sure to keep it on the quiet. The three who went up the mountain with Jesus are told to keep what happened to themselves. Now the reader, the hearer might presume, or at least hope, that the disciples finally comprehend the import of the transfiguration. But whatever they understood, they did not act on it. They kept it to themselves and told no one. But my guess is what they saw lingered for quite a while in their minds. It's interesting here, you know, more often than not in the Gospels, when Jesus tells someone, don't tell anyone, the first thing they do is they go tell somebody. And the disciples saw this. But here, because of what has transpired before them, they decide not to. Interesting. Following this moment, which seemed to end as quickly as it started, they do end up coming back down the mountain. It's in those moments, though, where the real work begins. The transfigured Jesus is changed, not in essence, but in the way he is seen. He acts in and for the world accordingly. Seeing Jesus differently means seeing oneself and others differently as well. Living up high in the rarefied air isn't the point of transfiguration. It was never meant as a private experience of spirituality removed from the public square, or it wouldn't be mentioned in the Gospels. It was a vision to carry us down, a glimpse of unimagined possibility at ground level. On one hand, the transfiguration is an affirmation of Jesus' divinity. On the other, it begins to give the disciples eyes to see God's light in the chaos to come. Death, loss, fear and resurrection, the work of the early church. The challenge to the disciples is to live in a world without Jesus' bodily presence, and for us to carry on with that knowledge. As that light shines in our hearts, the incarnate God is made real in the everyday. But I do know that sometimes we only glimpse things in fragments, unable to see the full picture. But we are still invited here to trust in the love of Jesus. Now, imagine being able to only see, let's say, a tiny corner of that picture, the starry night. Imagine, though, being told that, don't worry, the rest of it is really magnificent. You've got to trust me on this. Could we trust others to letting us know the truth in this? You know, I still don't know if my dad believes me when I told him that story about the satellite. I just know it was something amazing. The biblical witness invites us to trust in this scene, to embrace its possibilities, and to live into the promise of a Jesus transformed. But that doesn't take place high up. We must come down the mountain and into the brokenness of the world we inhabit. We must be prepared to share in the light of Christ for this world, knowing that we have been touched by the grace of God to doing the mission and ministry of the church. But you know, it's okay for us to admit to ourselves that the truth is, more often than not, we would love to be able to stay on the mountaintop. Luckily in Kansas, we don't have that problem. But by staying on that mountaintop, we are seeking to avoid the reality of the deep valleys we so often are walking around in. We want to busy ourselves with preserving something that can't be sustained. Like the disciples here, who are this close to God, they think that only by staying put high up will they be able to maintain that awesome feeling. And I think in the back of their minds, almost intuitively, do they know that this can't be sustained? That they do have to come down and get back to the daily routine where the real work is done. Now, we certainly recognize this. How many times have we been on vacation, wanting to desperately for it to go on and on, but then the creeping reality of its ending begins to take hold? I know whenever I go away, even if it's just for a day or two, there's part of that time spent thinking about the emails that await, or the little things that need to get done when I get back. And I think, wow, I try to figure out ways. How can I extend this vacation? What can I do to sustain this moment or this momentary feeling of just joy and relaxation or however you want to call it? If I can only just stay on this beach forever, who wouldn't like that? But there's much work to be done. And there's a recognition here that we need to move away from this continual high of the mountaintop and get back down to ground level so that God's work can continue to be cultivated in the world. Because the presence of God is still with us. Even when those moments of epiphany, of transcendence, of our seeming nearness to God passes. We are called down from the mountain to continue participating in God's work in the world. Even though we have to admit to ourselves that that could be really, really hard. I think one of the problems I have with this story is we don't want to deal with the uncertainty of the mystery of God in our lives. I think we want so much to know that Christ is in our hearts and that the presence of God is near. But when we do have those moments, when we see God in all of God's glory, we fumble too often to get out that camera so we can take that perfect picture of the moment, to build a booth or tent in our attempt to contain God on our own terms. If we snap that picture, we can control it rather than allow the Spirit to move as the Spirit moves. Because we know what happens when we come down from the mountain and into the reality of the valleys we find ourselves in. But just as Christ comes down with the dazed and confused disciples, so too does Christ continue with us. It is in our everyday living that God works in and through us, offering those moments of grace, even in the midst of our most harshest or even most mundane of circumstances. Christ has prepared the way for us, always leading and never faltering, even when we do. This scene was a brief moment in the life of Christ, but points to the promise of his death and resurrection. It points to the promise of the eternal hope that God has for us. It demonstrates that God's kingdom of love and justice is breaking into our daily lives whenever we extend the hand of kindness to someone else, offer forgiveness or ask to forgive, seek reconciliation with one another. We become participants in the transfiguration when we dare to let love rule and dare to believe in the impossible and dare to share Christ with others for the true transformation of the world. And so it is not a question of loitering up high, but being ready to come down with our eyes wide open to the reality of God's love for all people, to the reality of the trans transcendence of Christ to transform all hearts. And the willingness to look into our present valleys and know that not any one single picture will be able to capture the fullness of this journey of discipleship. But rather, it is this community of grace that is ready to shake up the world in the name of Christ's love as we begin this journey of salvation again together. Because this story is being told as we prepare ourselves for Ash Wednesday and the Lenten journey. The road ahead will not be easy as we are called to rid ourselves of the heavy loads we carry and instead lift up the load of the cross. It is a glimpse of the future of life with Christ. It is a reminder of what is to come with the glorified Jesus and that we are always welcome at Christ's side. But it also points not only to the promise that Christ, but also the church's sometimes stagnant reaction to grace being revealed. This is a fantastical moment in the life of faith where the identity of Christ is being shown. And we are offered that glimpse along with the disciples. The extraordinary is breaking into the ordinary, but far too often we want to be dismissive of those moments. The skeptical heart wants to reject the miraculous because we think we know how life really works. We are invited, though, to live into the extraordinary, to risking ourselves for the sake of the gospel, knowing where the journey is going to lead. By believing against all odds and loving against all odds, that is how we are to let Jesus show us how to walk in and transform the world together. Amen. Let us pray. Holy God, we are blessed by those moments where we experience the fullness of your love and your grace in ways that are transcendent. But we also know that through the sustaining Spirit, you will carry us forward as we walk on this journey of discipleship together. And for that, we are blessed. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Offering is a response to transformed lives and hearts. Here at Asbury, we demonstrate our offering through our prayers, our service, through our witness, our gifts, and through our presence in the lives of one another. You are invited again to recognize that through God, you are loved. You are children of God, ready to share in this journey of discipleship together. The ushers will come forward so that we can receive the offering.
Preparing the word of the Lord.
Gracious and loving God, receive our gifts of self and substance. They have belonged to you since our very beginning. We give them freely, joyfully, and prayerfully. With them we praise you. With them we celebrate the great power that is love, a love that abides always, a love that radically transforms, a love that makes us whole. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And our closing song is, We Have Come at Christ's Own Bidding.
Thank you.
Friends, may you go from this place refreshed and renewed in the Spirit, ready to carry the light of Christ out into the world, ready to experience God's transcendent grace in our daily walk. Go now in peace. Amen.
Happy birthday.